Hello everyone and welcome back to our channel. So as you are all aware of, we had started with the chapter the urinary system, in which we were dealing about the overview of the renal physiology. Okay, so before going into the actual renal physiology, that is the urine formation, we need to understand what are the basic processes which are involved in this urine production. What makes it possible for urine to be formed by the nephrons? So we have seen in the last lecture how the glomerular filtration takes place. What makes the blood plasma to get filtered out? We have seen the composition of the filtration membrane. We have seen how pressure differences allow this blood to get filtered out, whatever dissolved substances along with the water. How this particular process takes place, at what rate, that is the glomerular filtration rate, what is it, what are the different factors which will affect this GFR, how the regulation of this GFR takes place, because this is the main step in the urine formation. Okay, so unless and until filtration takes place, urine production will not start. But as we have seen, the rate of filtration is too high, right? A lot of plasma gets filtered out, right? Can you all recall the volume of the filtrate which is formed? It is known as glomerular filtrate, right? Whatever gets filtered out from the blood, the water and the dissolved substances, it is known as the glomerular filtrate. Okay, so that accounts around about 180 in liters in the males and 150 liters in the females, right? So that's a huge amount of the filtrate which is formed. But what is the amount of urine which is passed? That's around about 1 to 2 liters. So as we have seen, that most of the filtrate, it must have returned back to the blood, right? And apart from that, there may be certain additions also to this particular filtrate in the tubules. Okay, so this particular further passage through the renal tubules, this process takes place, the filtration takes place in the renal corpuscle, which is the first part of the nephron. The second part, that is the renal tubules, are the ones in which the remaining two processes, that is the tubular reabsorption and the tubular secretion, will take place, right? So some substances along with the water will get reabsorbed. Reabsorption, we have seen what is the meaning of reabsorption, and certain substances might have got secreted also. Okay, so let us talk about these two processes in today's video, that is tubular reabsorption and the tubular secretion. So why these are taken up together is because throughout the tubules, these two processes might be taking place, and sometimes reabsorption as well as secretion might take place simultaneously. So one substance will be reabsorbed, second substance will be secreted. So that is the reason why both these processes are discussed together. So before going into the actual process of reabsorption and secretion, how exactly it is taking place, let us understand the principles of these two processes, that is reabsorption and the secretion. So as we have already seen, that the filtration of the blood takes place at a very fast rate, right? So that within say half an hour, most of the blood plasma, it gets filtered out, right? So the glomerular filtration rate is very, very high, so that a very large volume of this filtrate will be formed. And we have seen that the urine output is very small, so it is obvious that most of the substances might have been returned to the bloodstream. So this is the representative picture which shows the two processes as we have seen in the introduction. The tubular reabsorption, wherein the contents from the lumen of the tubules, they are returned back to the blood. Whereas the secretion is a process in which certain substances from the blood will move towards the lumen of the tubule. So this is a representative picture which depicts these two processes. So as we have seen that the reabsorption, this is the process of the return of most of the filtered water and most of the filtered solutes back to the bloodstream. That's why it is known as the reabsorption. Okay, something which is already present in the body, it is filtered out over here and the same substances are returning back to your bloodstream. So that's why this particular process is known as reabsorption, which is the second basic function of the nephron and the collecting ducts. So as we have already seen earlier, that round about 99% of the filtered water is reabsorbed, and along with it several other solutes which are dissolved in this water, these will also get reabsorbed. So the epithelial cells, we have seen in the histology what are the different types of epithelial cells which are present throughout the nephron, right? So at a specific region, specific types of epithelial cells will be present to carry out the specialized functions, and there will be different types of transporters which are located at different levels or the different areas, as we have seen in the parts of the nephron, the tubules, PCTs, loop of Henle, DCTs and the collecting ducts. So there are different types of epithelial cells which are variably involved in this particular process of reabsorption. Okay, but out of all these parts, it is the proximal convoluted tubules which makes the major contribution towards the reabsorption. That is, the most of the substances will get absorbed at the first part itself. Okay, so the solutes that are reabsorbed, okay, certain substances will be reabsorbed by the active process or certain will be reabsorbed by passive processes. Okay, active means what? And what is the meaning of passive? Yes, here there is requirement of the energy, right? Energy is required in the form of ATP, whereas here energy is not required. Okay, so this process is against the concentration gradient and passive process is along the concentration gradient. So these are the differences between these processes. So these different types of processes may be utilized, transporters may be utilized for the reabsorption of these solutes. So a specific transporter may be available for a specific type of solute. So what are these different types of solutes which are reabsorbed? So these include the glucose, amino acids, urea, several ions such as the sodium ions, potassium ions, calcium ions, chloride ions, bicarbonate ions and the phosphate ions. So number of types of ionic components will also get reabsorbed, because we have seen that at the filtration process they are filtered out, right? Because they are very small. So they will also get reabsorbed, because imagine if all these are lost from the body, what will happen? Yes, correct. The electrolyte balance of the body will get disrupted, right? Because these ions, these are required by the body, right, in a specific amount. So if these are lost from the body, obviously this balance will get disrupted. So also most of the water is also getting filtered out, right? So what will happen if the water is not reabsorbed? Yes, this fluid electrolyte balance will get disrupted because of these two processes if they are getting affected. Okay, apart from that, most of the small proteins and the peptides which get filtered. Remember, these also get filtered, right? So these also will get reabsorbed by the process of pinocytosis, that is cell drinking. Okay, now coming to the different routes of reabsorption. Now, how exactly this reabsorption take place? So this is a representative picture of the epithelial cells which are lining your renal tubules. Okay, so that's the lumen, the space within the tubule. It's a tube-like structure, right? It's a tube-like structure. So the space which is present over here in between, that is called as the lumen, right? And this wall of the tubules, it is lined by a single layer of the epithelial cells we have seen, right? Throughout the nephron, there is only a single layer of cells which is lining this. So there will be cells which are present over here, right? A single layer of cells will be present throughout the wall. So these types of cells will vary depending upon the location. Correct? So these cells are represented over here, tubular cells. And this is your fluid which is filtered. Okay, so in this particular area, that is in the lumen, will be present the glomerular filtrate, right? So it will pass into the tubules further. So let us see how exactly this particular process of reabsorption will take place. Okay, so from here, from the lumen, the substances can cross this single layer of epithelial cells and it will reach into the interstitial fluid. And just outside the tubules, what is present? If you can remember, the blood supply, peritubular capillaries are supplying to these tubules, right? Most of them in the cortical region are supplied by the peritubular capillaries. And the loop of Henle, which passes deep into the medulla, it is supplied by the blood from the vasa recta, right? Okay, so blood capillaries are supplying to these renal tubules. There is a rich supply of blood capillaries. Now, what is the purpose of these blood capillaries? Is to bring the substances back from the lumen. It will enter into the blood capillaries. So, how they will enter? There are two main processes which are involved over here. Either they will enter through the paracellular spaces, that is the space in between these cells. Now, these are the two cells. This is the first cell, this is the second cell, that's the third cell. So, likewise, the number of cells will be present. Now, in between these two cells, there will be a gap. Now, no doubt there is tight junction which is present over here. Yet, these particular spaces are permeable to these smaller molecules, smaller ions. So, this is the first process by which the reabsorption can take place. Paracellular reabsorption. In between these cells, the ions will move from the lumen into the interstitial fluid, and from here it will be easily passed into the bloodstream. So this is how, this is the first method by which the substance will return back to the bloodstream. Now there is one more process by which the ions can move into the blood capillaries. So that is by means of the transcellular reabsorption. Okay, so this is your cell, this is the apical membrane, the ones which is facing towards the lumen, that is known as the apical membrane, and the one which is facing the interstitial fluid, that is known as the basolateral membrane, and towards it, towards each other, because here also there is a gap, right? Paracellular spaces. So membrane which is facing towards paracellular spaces and the interstitial fluid, that is known as the basolateral membrane, and the one which is facing the lumen, it is known as the apical membrane. Now, in these apical membrane, also there might be certain transporters which will help the ions to cross this membrane. So now this sodium, how it is entering the bloodstream? Is it moving directly? No, it is first entering inside this tubular cell by means of what type of transport this is? This is an active transport. So here energy will be required, transporters will be required, whereas this type of process, it is passive, it's diffusion. So here energy will not be required for paracellular reabsorption, but in this case mostly reabsorption takes place by the active transport. So now here sodium has entered from the lumen into the tubular cells. So how it will reach the interstitial fluid? Now again it has to cross this basolateral membrane also, right? So this substance has to cross two membranes now. The apical membrane to enter inside the cell and again to leave the cell from the other side, that is from the basolateral membrane. So in the basolateral membrane again there might be certain additional transporters which are present. Now as you can see, this is a sodium pump. Okay. So this is a sodium potassium pump. So it is helping the sodium to move into the interstitial fluid. Actually it also transports potassium also, but it is not depicted over here. Okay, because we are just talking about the reabsorption. So here energy is required and the sodium will be transferred towards the interstitial fluid. And from here it can easily cross the capillary endothelial cells because they are permeable, right? And it will easily enter your bloodstream. So this is how the reabsorption will take place. Now on the contrary, how the secretion process will take place? The process of secretion, how it will take place, in which direction? Secretion means a substance which is present in your blood. It will first move out of the blood capillaries, enter into the interstitial fluid. From here, it will move into the cells and from here it may be released into the lumen, or it may also cross via the paracellular spaces. Okay, so exactly opposite to this reabsorption routes will be the process of secretion which will take place. And most of the time both these processes of reabsorption and secretion, they take place simultaneously. Okay, not always but sometimes. You will come to know about this as we will discuss the different transporters and how exactly they are transporting which particular substance in which direction. I hope this is clear how exactly the reabsorption and the secretion takes place and what are the different ways by which it takes place. Okay, now let's talk about the process of reabsorption and secretion at different levels. So in different regions of the nephrons there are different types of transporters which are present. So a specific ion will move in a specific direction, either it will be reabsorbed or it will be secreted out. Okay, so let us see region wise what are these different transporters which are involved in the reabsorption and secretion of the substance. Now let us talk about the reabsorption and secretion in the first part of the renal tubules, that is the proximal convoluted tubules. As you can see that this particular process, okay, it is representing the processes in this particular region. Okay, so this is your lumen of the renal tubule, that's the cells, epithelial cell which is lining the PCTs. Okay, and these are supplied by the peritubular capillaries, right? Now the first type of transporter which is present over here is the sodium glucose symporter. Okay, so that's the representation. So as you can see over here in the apical membrane is present this transporter. Okay, so what it is transporting now, in which direction? Two sodium ions are moving inside the cells, right? and simultaneously what is getting transported? Glucose. So this transporter, as the name implies, sodium glucose symporter. Why symporter? What is the meaning of symporter? What is a symporter and antiporter? Well, must be familiar with these terms. So symporter is a transporter which transports two substances in same direction. As you can see, that sodium is also moving inside, glucose is also moving inside. So this is a symporter. And what is an antiporter? It moves the two substances in opposite direction. So this is a symporter because it is moving both the substances in same direction. Okay, so it is a sodium glucose symporter. Two ions of sodium are transported and one molecule of the glucose is transported. Now further, these two substances cross the basolateral membrane separately. Now sodium, it is transported towards the interstitial fluid with the help of this sodium potassium pump, sodium potassium ATPase. So ATP is required over here, right? ATP is hydrolyzed to ADP and sodium gets transported into the interstitial fluid, and from here it will cross the endothelial layer and it will reach the blood circulation. Whereas glucose, how it is getting transported into the interstitial fluid? The process is different now over here, right? What is this? It is the glucose facilitated diffusion transporter. What is a facilitated diffusion? It's the process of diffusion with the help of some transporter. So this substance cannot cross the membrane unless and until a transporter helps it. It moves along the concentration gradient, but it needs a transporter. So it is a process of diffusion, but it is a facilitated diffusion. So again, from here the glucose will enter into the bloodstream. Then the next type of transporter which aids in the reabsorption of sodium and secretion of the hydrogen ion. Okay, now here both the processes are taking place, reabsorption as well as secretion. Now the name of the transporter which is involved over here is sodium hydrogen antiporter. That means these two ions are moving in the opposite direction. Okay, so as you can see that the sodium, it is getting reabsorbed, right? It is moving into the cell. And what is happening to your hydrogen? Hydrogen ions are secreted. So both the processes are taking place over here. So further, from here sodium will enter into the interstitial fluid and blood by the same process as we have discussed earlier. Now where this hydrogen comes from? Unless and until this hydrogen moves out, sodium will not be reabsorbed. Okay, so both the processes takes place simultaneously. Any one ion cannot move. Okay, so this hydrogen, it is obtained from the carbon dioxide. It enters the cell either from the blood or from the lumen or the metabolic reactions. This is a source for carbon dioxide. It will react with water in presence of carbonic anhydrase. This is a much familiar process for you all. We have discussed this several times. So in presence of carbonic anhydrase, it will form the carbonic acid. And carbonic acid will dissociate into H plus ions and bicarbonate. So H plus will be secreted for one sodium to enter inside the cell. And this bicarbonate which is formed, it will get absorbed by the process of, this is what type of transporter? It's a facilitated diffusion transport. Then the next process is the reabsorption of the bicarbonate ion. So in the PCTs, bicarbonate is also reabsorbed. Whatever bicarbonate ions are released into the lumen, how it is entering into the bloodstream. Now actually this process is linked with this sodium hydrogen antiport. Okay, so this bicarbonate ions which are filtered, it will combine with the H plus ion which is secreted by this sodium hydrogen antiporter. to form the carbonic acid in presence of the carbonic anhydrase enzyme, the brush border enzyme. In turn, it will be easily split into water and carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide will enter into the cell. It will recombine with water to form the carbonic acid in presence of carbonic anhydrase within the cell. Again, it will split into H plus ions and the bicarbonate ions, as we have seen earlier. H plus will be recirculated. And what will happen to this bicarbonate? It will be absorbed into the blood circulation via the process of facilitated diffusion. Okay, so this is how the bicarbonate ions will be reabsorbed into the PCT. Then the next type of processes which take place is the reabsorption of several other smaller ions, like say chloride ions, potassium ions, calcium ions, magnesium ions, urea. So all these ions will get reabsorbed by what processes now? This process is the diffusion, right? Either through the paracellular spaces or transcellular. So either it can travel along the paracellular space or it will enter the cell and then move into the interstitial fluid and blood. And apart from these ions and small molecules, water is also getting reabsorbed, most of the water. Again, water will also travel along the paracellular spaces or transcellular processes by the process of osmosis, correct? So here the concentration of the solutes, if it is high as compared to the lumen, what will happen to water? Obviously, to adjust the osmolarity, water will get reabsorbed, right? By the process of osmosis. That process is known as osmosis. Remember the semi-permeable membrane which we had discussed, through which the water can cross. Okay, so by the similar process, water will also get reabsorbed in the PCTs. Then coming to the process of reabsorption in the loop of Henle. Why reabsorption now? Only because the substances are entering into the blood. Is anything getting secreted out? No. Now, what is the name of the transporter which is involved over here? Sodium, potassium, 2-chloride symporter. So again, symporter means all the substances are moving in same direction. They are moving from the lumen into the cells. Now what are these different ions which are moving? One sodium ion, one potassium ion, and 2-chloride ions are moving. So electrostatically balanced ions are moving across the membrane. Two positive, two negative charges are moving, right? With the help of this particular symporter. Further, sodium will cross with the help of sodium pump. And the chloride will enter the interstitial fluid through the leakage channels. The chloride channels. And this process which is involved is the diffusion. Process of diffusion. Apart from that, what is happening to your potassium ions? Is it getting reabsorbed? It is moving out of the cells by the leakage channels. So it will just leak out of this particular apical surface. Now have you noticed the difference in the types of cells? In the earlier, the PCTs, there were brush borders over here, right, in the apical membrane. But it is absent over here in the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. Okay, so this potassium ions, it is just helping these two to cross the membrane. What is happening to your potassium? Is it getting secreted? It is actually moving out of the cell. But can you call this a process of secretion? What do you mean by secretion? Some substance moving from the blood into the lumen. That process is known as secretion, right? But what is happening from where this potassium is coming? Actually, it is getting recirculated over here, right? to aid the absorption, reabsorption of these two ions. So you can't call this process of movement of the potassium out of the cell as secretion. Apart from that, through the paracellular spaces also some reabsorption is taking place, right, of the sodium ions, potassium ions, calcium ions, magnesium ions. But is the water getting reabsorbed over here? No, because this membrane is impermeable to water. So water will not get reabsorbed in the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. Then coming to the reabsorption in the early distal convoluted tubule, in the starting part. So the name of the transporter which is present over here is the sodium chloride symporter. That means one sodium ion and one chloride ion is moving into the cell. It is getting reabsorbed. Here again secretion is not taking place. And what is happening to your sodium? As usual, it will travel into the blood. And the chloride, it is moving into the interstitial fluid through the leakage channels. And from here, it will enter into your blood circulation. So, only the reabsorption of sodium and chloride will take place in this particular region. That is the early distal convoluted tube. Now let us talk about the reabsorption and secretion process in the late distal convoluted tubule, DCT, later part, and the collecting duct in this region. Now remember, there are two types of cells which are present in this region, collecting ducts, the intercalated cells and the principal cells, right? So these are the principal cells through which the processes are taking place, the process of reabsorption and the secretion. Now what is happening over here? By the process of diffusion, is there any active transport which is involved in the reabsorption? No. Okay, so it's the simple diffusion by which sodium is entering into the cell. From here it will get reabsorbed into the bloodstream by the help of this sodium potassium pump. So what is happening to this potassium ions now? They are getting secreted out, right, through leakage channels. But at the basolateral membrane, it is the active transporter. It's the sodium potassium pump which is utilizing the one molecule of ATP to transfer the sodium and potassium in the opposite directions. Sodium is getting reabsorbed and potassium is getting secreted out. Okay, so this is to do with the different transporters which are involved in the reabsorption and the secretions. Now coming to the regulation of these two processes. Basically, these two processes are regulated by different types of hormones. So there are five hormones which basically affect the reabsorption of the sodium, chloride, calcium and water, as well as secretion of the potassium ions. We have seen potassium is secreted, right, whereas these ions are getting reabsorbed along with the water. So the hormones which control these processes include the angiotensin II, aldosterone, antidiuretic hormone, atrial natriuretic peptide and parathyroid hormone. So coming to the first one, angiotensin II, which is actually a part of renin angiotensin aldosterone system. Of course, we will be dealing with this detail again in the later videos. Okay. So just keep in mind that when blood volume or the blood pressure, it decreases. Actually, this system is involved in adjustments of the blood pressure. You all must have come across this in your CVS also. Okay, so when the blood volume or the blood pressure decreases, the walls of these efferent arterioles which are entering your glomerulus, glomerular capsule. These are stretched less, right? Stretching decreases. So this is sensed by the juxtaglomerular apparatus, right? Remember, it helps in adjusting the blood pressure. That's what we have seen, juxtaglomerular apparatus. So these cells which are present, juxtaglomerular cells, what are these? These are the modified smooth muscles which are present in the walls of these efferent arterioles. So as the blood volume and pressure decreases, stretching will be reduced of these arterioles because less blood will be flowing through these blood vessels, right? So stretching of these walls, that will be reduced. So this will be sensed, and in response to this, an enzyme called renin will be released into the blood by the kidneys. Even the sympathetic stimulation also is responsible for the release of the enzyme renin. Okay, now what is the role of this enzyme renin? So this renin, it clips off an peptide called angiotensin 1. It's a 10 amino acid peptide, decapeptide it is. So it is clipped off from the precursor angiotensinogen. So this is synthesized by the hepatocyte, the angiotensinogen. It is normally present. So this renin, it clips off the 10 amino acid peptide which is called as angiotensin 1. Now from this angiotensin 1, two more amino acids are clipped off by another enzyme known as angiotensin converting enzyme, or ACE it is known as. So this results in formation of angiotensin 2. It's an octapeptide. So this is actually an active hormone. Now, how it affects the renal physiology? There are three ways by which it affects the renal physiology. First of all, it will decrease the GFR, glomerular filtration rate is decreased. How? By resulting the vasoconstriction of the efferent arterioles. Remember, vasoconstriction of these efferent arterioles, what will happen? The blood flowing into the corpuscles. If this is your corpuscle, this is the efferent arteriole which is entering into these capillaries, and this is the efferent arteriole. So if this is constricted, what will happen? The blood flowing into the glomerulus, it will get decreased. So obviously the GFR also will reduce. Next mechanism is it enhances the reabsorption of sodium chloride and water in the PCTs by stimulating the activity of the sodium hydrogen antiporters. Next mechanism is that it will stimulate the adrenal cortex. Okay, we'll be dealing about this particular hormone in detail in the endocrine system. The adrenal glands will be studying in detail. So adrenal cortex, it releases an hormone called as aldosterone. So this angiotensin 2, it enhances the release of this hormone aldosterone by the adrenal cortex. So this aldosterone in turn will stimulate the principal cells in the collecting ducts to reabsorb sodium and chloride and secrete more and more potassium. Remember the principal cells when we had discussed, we had talked about the receptors for aldosterone. If you all can recall, it contains the receptors for the aldosterone. So this aldosterone, which is released by the adrenal cortex, it will act on these principal cells to reabsorb more and more sodium and chloride and secrete more and more potassium. So as a result of the changes in the ionic composition, by reabsorbing more and more sodium and chloride, water is also reabsorbed, right? So as a result of this, it will increase the blood volume and the blood pressure. So all these mechanisms, it will alter the renal physiology. In some way or the other, it is affecting the renal physiology. Next hormone which is controlling these processes is antidiuretic hormone, or it is also known as ADH or vasopressin, which is released by the posterior pituitary gland. Of course, we will be dealing with this also in detail in the endocrine system. Okay, so just keep in mind that this hormone is also regulating the urine output, because it regulates the water reabsorption. This particular hormone, when it is released, reabsorption of water is increased, okay, by increasing the water permeability of the principal cells which are present in the last part of the DCT and the CD. Antidiuretic hormone, diuretic. Diuresis means secretion of water and sodium. That's the actual meaning. Now, antidiuretic hormone means the diuresis is opposed. That is, the loss of water and sodium is inhibited by this particular hormone. Now, in the absence of this ADH, what will happen? The water permeability of these cells, it will reduce. Okay, so by releasing this particular hormone, the alteration in the water permeability of these cells is made possible. Now let us see how exactly the permeability of water is altered. Now within these principal cells, if you can recall this, there are two types of cells, intercalated cells and the principal cells. Now within these cells are present tiny vesicles which contains the copies of water channel protein. Water channel proteins are present within the vesicles over here. So these water channel proteins, these are known as aquaporin 2. Now when ADH is released, it stimulates this insertion of aquaporin 2 containing vesicles into the membrane. Okay, so these vesicles which are present over here, it will get incorporated into the membrane. By the process of exocytosis, within these vesicles, whatever channels are present, it will get inserted over here. Aquaporin 2. So, as a result of insertion of more and more channels, what will happen? These channels aid in the movement of water from the tubular cells into the cells. So, what will happen? More and more water will get reabsorb into the cells, and from here it will move into the interstitial fluid and from there into the blood circulation. Okay, so what will happen in presence of ADH? What will happen to your urine output? Will it increase or decrease? ADH promotes the secretion and the insertion of the aquaporin 2 channels which reabsorb the water. So when more and more ADH will be released, what will happen to the urine output? More and more water is reabsorbed. So what will happen to your urine output? There will be very low volume of urine output, as little as 400 to 500 ml urine will be produced, concentrated, very concentrated. Why? Because the water level, it is low. Usual volume of urine is 1 to 2 liters, right? So, as low as half a liter of urine will be passed, and which will be concentrated in nature, because more and more water has got reabsorbed. Now, what will happen if the ADH levels decline? If it decreases, what will happen to these aquaporin channels? These will be removed from the membrane. It will be removed. So what will happen to the process of reabsorption of water? Will it take place? No, it will not take place. So what will happen to your urine output? It will be increased because the water is excreted out. So what will be produced? Dilute urine will be formed in the absence of the ADH. So this is the role of the antidiuretic hormone. So there is a negative feedback system which is involved over here in the water reabsorption. So when the osmolarity of the plasma or the osmotic pressure of the plasma or interstitial fluid is high due to the increase in the solute content. Now when does the solute content increase? When the water concentration in your blood plasma is low, as little as 1% of change, it is sensed by the osmoreceptors which are present in the hypothalamus. Okay, so if there is any situation which disrupts this homeostasis by increasing the osmolarity of the plasma and interstitial fluid due to low level of water, osmolarity increases. So osmoreceptors in the hypothalamus, it will sense this increase in osmolarity. So it will send the signal to the posterior pituitary gland to release more and more ADH. What is the role of ADH now? Your blood water level is low. What will ADH do? It will act on the principal cells to insert more and more aquapora in two channels. So it will increase the permeability of water, so it will increase the reabsorption of the water. So as a result of this, what will happen? More and more water will get reabsorbed into your bloodstream and it will decrease the plasma osmolarity. So it will return the homeostasis back to normal. Okay. Apart from this, there is one more stimulus for the release of ADH. That is the decrease in the blood volume. So if blood volume decreases, again it will be sensed. ADH will be released, more and more water will be reabsorbed and it will help in conservation of the blood volume. Okay. Say for example in hemorrhage, excessive blood loss or dehydration, you lose more and more water from the body, right? So ADH will be secreted. So there is a pathological condition also, okay, in which the ADH secretion, it is low. So in this particular situation, diabetes insipidus like condition, that is the urine output will be very high in this particular situation. And the next hormone which is regulating these processes of reabsorption and secretion is atrial natriuretic peptide. This also we have covered earlier. So when there is increase in the blood volume, it promotes the release of atrial natriuretic peptide from the heart, atria. So what this hormone will do? It can inhibit the reabsorption of the sodium and water in the PCTs and CD. Also, it will suppress the secretion of the aldosterone and ADH. Okay, so what will happen as a result of this? As a result of inhibition of reabsorption of sodium and water, what will happen? More and more water will be excreted out of the body and it will help in reducing the blood volume. So also it suppresses these two hormones. This will again help in reducing the blood volume. Okay, so this particular effect of increase in the excretion of sodium in the urine, that process is known as natriuresis. Excessive loss of sodium in the urine. And if increase in the urine output, it is known as diuresis. Actually here sodium and water both are lost. So as a result of this, what will happen? It will help in decreasing the blood volume and ultimately the blood pressure. Next hormone which is regulating these processes are parathyroid hormone. This also will be dealing with in the endocrine system. Now when this hormone is secreted, when there is low levels of calcium in the blood. So it will stimulate the parathyroid glands to release more and more parathyroid hormone, that is PTH. So this in turn will stimulate the cells in the early distal convoluted tubules to reabsorb more and more calcium in the body. Remember, calcium reabsorption takes place at this level. So also the parathyroid hormone, it inhibits the phosphate reabsorption in the proximal convoluted tubule. So as a result of this, it will promote the excretion of the phosphate ions from the body. So these are the different hormones which will control or regulate the processes of reabsorption and secretion in the different parts of the nephron. Okay, so we have seen what are the different transporters at different regions of the nephron which are involved in movement of specific ions in a specific direction. So we have seen that reabsorption of certain ions will take place and secretion of certain ions will take place. And sometimes both the reabsorption and secretion might take place simultaneously with the help of same transport. Okay, so with this brief overview of renal physiology, we'll talk about the urine formation. So it is very important to understand all these processes to understand how exactly the urine formation takes place, how the dilute urine gets formed or why the concentrated urine is formed. Okay, so this is the reference. Thank you for watching.